World is a complicated place with all of its injustice, skullduggery and batfuckery. But football is one place where we can rely on justice, authenticity, honesty, community. Why? Because football is nice. And what a week it's been in the beautiful game, with West Ham United quite rightly being crowned Kings of Europe with their victory against Fiorentina in the only European competition that matters. Elsewhere, Manchester City had a narrow victory against Inter Milan that no one seems to very much care about.
No.
This is very much a week defined by West Ham United and their successes. In fact, this story for me evokes the purpose of this podcast, that football can be an opportunity for communities to come together, to find unity and unification. A ceremony can be created that unleashes elsewhere repressed joy. Where was the joy before it was unleashed by West Ham's victory against Fiorentina? What condition were my dad's ribs in before the goal celebration that followed Jared Bowen's 90th minute strike? Hull's own, yep. Jared Bowen.
Yep.
In a way, like, in fact, our abilities to predict things look fantastic. Because I think I said something about Saeed Benrahma last week prior to the game. You certainly brought up Jared Bowen, and I believe you correctly predicted the entire score, making you very much the Man City of our own little league. A corporatized giant.
That's right.
Plays the game by any means necessary, unlike me. A plucky underdog. A plucky, belching underdog. Later on, we're going to be talking to Julian Dix, who's perhaps West Ham's most beloved ever fullback, along with the likes of Ray Stewart, Geordie Parish. I mean, the list goes on. Yeah. Young RoboCop who's there now. it was an amazing game. In fact, a lot of West Ham fullbacks are hard. Stuart Pearce, very hard.
Yeah.
Soufal, I feel, is hard.
You would imagine.
And there's no doubt in the hardness of Julian Dix, who we'll be talking to a little bit later about his book Hammer Time: Me, West Ham, and a Passion for
the Shirt.
It's
a great title.
Of course it is. Hammer Time.
Brilliant.
About time someone referenced MC Hammer in
Absolutely.
The title of their autobiography. Julian Dix was the man to ultimately do that. And what a week it's been for meeting West Ham heroes. Before we get into the events of Prague, which is where the final took place, I want to tell you a personal story. In the semi-final against AZ Alkmaar, right, West Ham... Well, there was some violence. Of course, that didn't involve West Ham fans, who historically have been among the best behaved fans in the game. But it did involve those, I'm going to call them Dutch monsters of AZ Alkmaar, who invaded the friends and family section at the stadium for the away game there in Amsterdam. Two men stood against the tide, the torrent of hooligans. Famously, Knowlesy, here he is, doing exactly that. Right, well, the other day, Gal, there was some filming taking place down my street.
Yeah.
Well, when I say down my street, I mean down my river. Mm. Because
you think of it as yours, don't you?
Basically, it actually belongs to everyone.
Yeah.
When you think about it, it's ludicrous that anyone would claim to own a street, a river, or anything, because we're all temporarily here, and it seems that there is some permanent haunting within nature that belies the deeper truth that none of us own anything, not even our own bodies, our own lives. Anyway, they were filming Midsummer Murders, which is like a British cop show that's sort of very sort of slow and lethargic. Like, American cop shows are very much like, hey, fuck you, and like The Wire. But British cop shows are like, now I put it to you that your auntie stowed the arsenic in a jam jar. Aren't they? They're all things like that.
It's quaint, isn't it? Very local as well.
Yeah.
You know, they'll take place in like one bit of a village or something.
Yeah. And there's too many murders in that village.
There's far too many going on in one village.
What you've got to look at is the quaint homicide axis.
Yeah.
It may score very high in quaintness in this village, but as you can see, every hour there is a lethal, deadly, unnecessary murder. Would you consider moving to the city? Oh no, there's too much crime.
Mm. They're bipolar, the residents of Midsummer.
You're right.
They're
how do you
going
mean?
Around throwing like tea parties and things one minute, but by night they're committing crimes.
Do you put the cream or the jam first on your scone, Vicar? I'll cut your fucking throat! Oh, bloody hell! I don't want to live in no more. Anyway, they were filming an episode of that a couple of gardens down on the river.
You had to get involved, didn't you?
Of course I did. Because you know how like people, when they're filming, they act like it's the world's most serious thing. Have you ever gone past a film set? Let me know in the chat. They're like, please, like if there's a road or anything, they stop traffic and wear high-vis vests. Like it's the world's most important thing that's ever happened. Like they're conducting heart surgery. Really, what are you doing? We're making Midsummer's Murder, a highly improbable TV show. Whatever it is, it's irrelevant, isn't it? They're ridiculous. So they're taking it so serious. We're making Batman. There's a man over there pretending to be a bat. Slow down, but we've got to get this ambulance. The kidney surgery is imminent. He's pretending that he wants to be a bat. What? How exactly did he acquire this desire? Well, he was in a bat cave carrying out his normal routine of bat-related activities, culminating, of course, in the world-famous bat fuck, and then he became a vigilante. That's a reference to the rest of the show. You have to look or watch that on Rumble if you listen to this as a podcast. Anyway, so
you saw that Midsummer Murders were being filmed.
A couple of gardens along.
And you thought to yourself...
And my children. I thought to myself and I thought to my children.
I bet you thought, hang on a second, guest appearance in Neighbours... Guest appearance in Midsummer Murders, more like.
Yeah, and I thought, I'll get a guest appearance out of this. Mm. And also, I can do what I like. Like, you can't stop me doing what I like.
Right.
So I went by boat to the end of the garden.
Yeah.
And I was like, ooh. And like someone went, shh. Oh, we're doing so important. Shh, it's important what we're doing here. Right, and I was like, I goes, what are you? You first AD to this kid.
Nice.
Let them know I know the nomenclature.
Sure.
I know the lingo.
Why did you think they were first AD?
I didn't think that they was the first idea. I thought it was time to say a bit of language separated me from the sort of person that can be shushed.
What is this, 4x3 or 16x9?
We're shooting that on, mate. 4K. It's good there. Oh, no. You've made a mistake there, mate. This is murder plot.
Should I have done it in black and white?
That's how I make all my films. Mate, black and white these days, more classy, you know what I mean? Seventh Seal, it's my favourite. What's this, Bergman? Karasaki, this is it? Right, so I goes, you first AD? He goes, third. I goes, go and get the first AD. Go and get the first. I ain't even talking to you, mate. Anyway, so the first AD comes out. A few people recognise me. It starts to seem like I'm being welcomed, quite rightly, as a visiting dignitary, which is what I am.
You were up in for John Nettles, weren't you? He's not even on it anymore.
Of course. Nettles, he's long gone, Nettles. Yeah. You'll be lucky to get Nettles, but I see your Nettles... Mm. And I'll raise you Knowles, right? Because bowling over comes none other than the angel of Alkmaar himself, Knowlesy.
What?
He comes bowling over. Here's a photograph of me with him. He goes, Russell. Knowlesy, like that. And he's a unit. He's a big fella.
Wow.
And also, I'm sort of engaged in what could be regarded as an act of essentially trespass.
Yes.
Because I'm coming into a territory. Well, that's the very thing that those AZ Alkmaar fans were doing. So I could have antagonised Knowlesy.
Expecting a stiff upper...
Well, it'd have been mostly they were over. What kind of punch is that, Dan? That's a sort of an overhead punch. He would like, like an overhand blow to the skull.
That's what I was expecting.
That's what he was delivering to those people coming up the stairs. Anyway, he was there. His son-in-law, who's the other lad with the green hoodie up, he was there. They're grips on Midsummer Murders.
Oh, I thought he might be playing the murderer.
No, of course he's not Knowlesy.
Right.
He's also, he denounced all glamorisation of hooliganism and violence. He's not like that way at all.
Well
I noticed
done.
He was wearing a Poppy Day sort of bracelet, or band type thing. Oh, he was lovely. I got photos done with him, photos done with his nephews. I was all over that set for a while. My children, very bored of the Midsummer's Murders set.
But hang on, wasn't he meant to be escorting you away from the set? Wasn't that the job that he was paid to do?
No, that's not his job. He just came over to say hello and like we
made a
connection.
Oh, he's not security. Sorry.
No, he's not. He's a grip.
He's a grip. Yeah.
Yeah, I think he might be the gaffer.
What's
in fact,
what are these moves, technical terms like that you use, Russell?
Oh, I just use them. To me, they ain't even technical terms.
I've never heard of these terms.
Technical
Someone
terms.
Someone who's worked in the industry.
Technical terms, I use them. Yep, that's right. Oh, hey, listen. Oh, my God. We've only got a few minutes before Julian Dix. Anyway, so that is my encounter with Knowlesy. We're now firm friends.
Got his number in your phone? Of course, you got his number in your phone.
I didn't get Knowlesy's number. But look at the softness to him. Look at the beauty to him. Look at the look how gentle and kind he looks. He's still got the remains of his shiner acquired that day.
He has.
Well, the reason that we're celebrating football is because of heroes like Knowlesy who emerge from the context of the game and the ceremonies therein. Do you want to have a look? Let's have a look at West Ham kid. I love this. This is a kid who can't be older, in my mind, than 7 or 8 years old. And yet he's already learned how to be a proper West Ham fan. He's like, I can't believe we've won something. He's only been alive 10 minutes. Maybe we weren't even born in 2006 when we were in the FA Cup final and lost to Liverpool. But and yet he's already acquired the lacrimose, remorseful quality of a West Ham fan. He's sad in that. And also, even in a quick mainstream media interview, he gets a dig in at Tottenham Hotspur.
My word.
Very accomplished. Have a look at this lovely West Ham supporting lad.
This is the best night of my life ever. I just can't believe I'm here. I think I'm dreaming. I just can't believe West Ham have won something. We won more titles than Spurs tonight. I just can't believe this. Nobody won.
The mum very proud there. He's got that digging.
West Ham are the best club in the world. I'm saying it. West Ham are the best club in the world. Go what you are. Yeah.
Wow. Amazing. Lovely, wasn't it?
That's...
You know, like at Liverpool, they say this means more. Yeah. Like somehow it's got more meaning. Mm. And it's a weird idea that something could have more meaning. But if you contrast the... And like, I know Man City fans, I know you had your long period in the wilderness. And I'm not. This is not about Man City fans. This is about the co-opting of your beautiful club by corporate interests and even national interests, global interests, that currently align with your agenda as a fan because you want to see your team win. I went on Talk Sport with the brilliant Simon Jordan and adorable Jim White, and we had a conversation about how, like, you know, the problem in the game is player wages. And I said, that can't be the problem in the game, player wages, because the intention of the various corporate and globalist interests that are purchasing football clubs can't be, how do we pay footballers more money?
Yep.
There must be another reason. And when you know what that reason is, corporatization, sports washing, commodification, creating global brands, ultimately a global super league, that is the thing that needs to be addressed by regulation. If you regulate a symptom, you don't deal with the problem. It's just plain and obvious to me, if not Simon Jordan, who's going to come on the show, actually. He's going to come here live, Gareth, so we'll be dealing with Simon Jordan. That'll be exciting. If you're a football fan, post your questions in the chat. Now, but like you can see how much this means to West Ham. I mean, in a way, it could be argued that West Ham fans have overreacted.
Yeah, I mean, that kid, you could imagine him doing the same thing if he didn't want to go to bed one night. You know, that's the kind of reaction that children give.
Please, I just can't go to bed. I've got so much to live for. You're a long time dead. I can't believe it. What's the point of dying? What's the point of going to bed and just going to dream about bloody Tottenham Hotspur and David Blee and Martin Yell? I can't take it. What's the point of Berbatov? What's the point of having a player if he's just going to sell him? What's the point of Gareth Bale?
You're right. He's sort of like the level of emotional commitment. Yeah. And also the sort of the bus tour at around East London, which I didn't attend, was like just looked amazing. Mm. I can't help but think, what would happen if you were able to harness and direct this energy that's plainly there and is released at the moment of victory? What would happen if it was directed towards the very thing that football is, in my opinion, essentially celebrating: togetherness, unity, common cause, overcoming the odds, many themes. But I wonder what would happen if it was differently directed.
Yeah, you're right, because it also doesn't pertain to whatever level the victory comes at. You know, like you were saying, like, you know, I watched the conference final and you know, Wrexham going up and the kind of euphoria that can come. It doesn't matter what level it is. And then, you know, Knox County and all of that. It's really incredible. So I get so carried away and quite emotional by clubs that I have literally nothing to do with, I don't remotely care about. But when you see the kind of passion and the joy that it elicits and creates, you're right that we all have that ability in us. We all want to feel in the way that these people are feeling. We just don't have the opportunity to.
Yogananda, the mystic and prophet, said that within you is a river of joy that you are prevented from accessing by your conditioning, but it is there. The function of ceremony beyond the context of sport is to elicit and access energies that are otherwise latent and dormant. That's the point in a wedding or a funeral. In an increasingly secularized society, you don't get the opportunity for religious ceremony anymore because religion has been superseded by rationalism. But when, even in a sporting context, you create ceremony, as you rightly say, Gareth, it doesn't matter what the economic rewards are or even the degree of excellence that we're celebrating. There's obviously no question that Manchester City are the best football team in the world, maybe ever. I mean, they're a phenomenal team. managed by an extraordinary coach with incredible resources, playing the game to an unbelievably high level. But the fact is that elsewhere, as you say, mate, whether it's Notts County or Wrexham or West Ham winning a cup where, if you look at it plainly on paper, there's the teams that qualify for the Champions League, then there's the teams that qualify for the Europa League, then there's the teams that qualify for the... But think of the playoffs. I've always thought that the playoffs in which the top teams of a division outside of the top two, so the teams between usually third and... seventh or sixth, play against each other. I've always thought, bloody hell, that's sort of better than if you'd gone up as champions, really.
That's amazing.
You get a day at a stadium, you get a trophy, it's exciting, it's thrilling, because the ceremony unleashes something that's there anyway. It's already there. You can't create it. It's no one's pouring something into each individual, but communally, an energy is conjured up.
You're right. That kid cannot possibly understand the kind of tragedy that you associate with West Ham over the years, in footballing terms, I mean.
Yeah.
But, you know, but he's accessing something, isn't it?
Although elsewhere, the tragedies are directly connected to football, particularly, you know, with the club Liverpool, with the disasters around the 97 that died, and the, you know, the Heysel disaster. Here's an amazing thing as well. Like, David Moyes, the manager of West Ham, has been derided for his, you know, he took the poison chalice of managing Manchester United immediately after Ferguson. Mm. And he, whilst his success in retrospect is comparable to some of the other people that have taken on the role in the interceding years, he was sort of much maligned. And then his periods at Sunderland and Real Sociedad were regarded as failures. So he similarly is affected by the ceremony. He's not like, oh, well, this is a third tier European competition. Who cares? It's not important. I mean, if you didn't know anything about football, and I barely do, you would sort of think, well, you, how would you measure the importance of the event? Look at all the people in the street. Like, well, and how can you bring it down by sort of going, oh, excuse me, it's not as important as that? That's, well, what's the most relevant thing? What's the realest thing? Joy in your heart, or someone pointing to a bit of paper saying, this team has got loads more money?
Yeah.
Like, you know, you can't, like, what analytic are you going to apply to it? Here's David Moyes giving the medal to his father. Now, for, like, again, what is it telling you about what it means? What relationships are being enshrined, celebrated, articulated, explored through the medium of football? That's why we do this podcast. Yes, we love football, but we're not analysts, or Gareth much more than me, analysts of strategy and tactics and stuff. Our mate Brian McDermott, who's the director of football up at Hibs, says, Gareth's a football man, like Gareth understands it. Me, I understand it from a culture and poetic perspective. You know, I like need stuff really spelled out to me. Like, I wouldn't notice, well, that's because that fullback's drunk. I suppose that fullback's been rooming with Paul Gascoigne and hasn't had any sleep. We'll be talking to Julian Dix about exactly that in a minute. But it's like, it's the power of the game to bring forth moments like this. Yeah. David Moyes giving his winner's medal to his 87-year-old father, I think. So that's love. It's love. It's
watching love. That has the ability to make me cry more than watching like a really emotional film. Like something about things like that. And I know it's, we always kind of talking about it, is the kind of masculinity that you associate with the male version of football mixed with the kind of emotions. It's incredible.
It's a very powerful elixir that, because we can intuit that David Moyes, centre back in his playing career, throughout his life would have had a relationship with his father, the encouragement of his father, he would have shared in the disappointments and the heartbreak with his father.
God.
And in that moment, comes to his moment of absolute triumph, he gives it to his father. Mm-hmm. It's like, that's more powerful than words can deliver. So when people are talking about football, they're not talking about football. Mm. They're talking about something. They're talking about love, or they're talking about disappointment, or they're talking about betrayal, or they're talking about injustice. It's a very, very powerful social tool. And I've always, not always, but I now believe that the movements that coalesce and gather around football could be mobilized to create a powerful and potent social movement. And Here's a person who understands the powerful elixir that is masculinity, skill, and footballing greatness. Played 325 times for West Ham, during which period he scored 65 goals. He's a West Ham legend in the truest sense of the word. Legend means the story is often told and he represents something powerful. It's Julian Dix. All right, Julian.
Hi, Russell. How are you?
Feel all right, mate. Thanks for coming on to talk about your book, Hammer Time, Me, West Ham, and a Passion for the Shirt. There's some fantastic stories in here. The one that's caught my attention is about you sharing a room with Paul Gascoigne. We talk about Paul Gascoigne a lot because, as well as being one of the best footballers these islands have ever produced, he somehow represented something beyond football. Like, he didn't stop mucking around. Like, almost everyone who knows Paul Gascoigne will tell a story about him, like, being in their house in the dead of night or stealing a double-decker bus. That's an actual example. What happened to you when you shared a room with Gazza, Julian?
Well, we were away with the under-21s in Toulon in France, and Dave Sexton, manager, said, who wants to share with Paul Gascoigne? No one put their hand up. So I put my hand up. The worst decision I ever made in football. he was a person that never slept. The amount of times I woke up with his backside on my face was, I've lost count. But
he
there was
did
one
that.
Night.
Why do you think in the middle of the night, Paul Gascoigne thinks, I'll tell you what, I'm going to put my face in Julian's, no, my arse in Julian's face. If he'd put his face in your arse, would that have been worse or better? Worse, I think, really.
It would have been worse. But he was such a good lad. He was such a good. He had such a good aura about him as well. But there was one night, my bed was right next to the toilet, and he put 20 firecrackers around the toilet seat, and he lit one, and they lit every single one. I thought it was a bomb, so I've jumped out of my bed. I've jumped over his bed, and I started running down the corridor naked, and Dave Sexton come out, all the directors come out, some of their wives are out there, and I'm naked. I got my hands over my parts, and obviously Gazza's in the doorway just laughing his head off. But I'm the one that got in trouble for that and not Gascoigne.
Yeah, I bet, because I know what happens with people like that. They go, Julian, you was meant to be looking after Gazza. What have you been doing? Letting him put his ass in your face and letting him set off firecrackers and stuff like that. Mate, could you tell us about that time that you went to a nightclub in Singapore and you had an injury at the time?
Yeah, I broke my ankle a few weeks before, and we were going to Australia. So our stop off was over in Singapore, and Frank Lampard was looking after us at the time. Harry wasn't there. But Frank was looking after us. He said, like, you can go out for a boys' night out. So we all went to this nightclub. Bouncer stopped me because I had a cast on my leg. He said, you can't come in. So all the boys still went in the nightclub. Didn't give a shit about me. So I went back to my club doctor. I said, look, you've got to cut this off. I said, the bouncer won't let me in the nightclub. He went, well, I haven't got the right tools. So I've got a bread knife. And he cut it off with a bread knife. And I went back to the nightclub and the bouncer let me in.
That's a proper in my day story. I can't imagine today's revelers like Jack Grealish being willing to get the old bread knife out and hack off a cast. Julian, in a recent poll, you were voted, I think, the hardest footballer above the likes of Razor Ruddock, Vinnie Jones, and of course, Big Dunk Ferguson. What does that mean, do you think, when people say that you're hard? Does it just mean that you had a lot of red cards? Does it mean you played the game in a certain way? And why is it, do you think, that that aspect of the sport is something that's fetishized and celebrated and that people admire?
I think, obviously, with my red cards and my fights I used to have on the pitch, stood me as number one. I can't believe Razor was in the top, even in the top 10, to be honest. Big Dunk, yeah, Big Dunk was a handful, and Vinny was a handful. But back then, you had to look after yourself. You had to look after yourself, the players you come up against. And as I said, the players that I used to play against, people like Franz Kard, Tony Daly, Rule Fox, they were rapid. They were so quick, they could give me 5 yards over 10 and still beat me. But luckily, back then, you could kick people. Mm-hmm. And I did kick many of them. And if I caught them two or three times, they wouldn't come back.
See, so it's in a sense using a maybe a slightly less explicit aspect of the sport to gain an advantage. But one of the other things that I'm like a lot of people know, but many people watching may not know, is that your managerial career and your career as a coach has involved coaching female teams, West Ham Ladies, and I think some other clubs as well. There's almost part of the culture war is about the ownership of the sport. You can see that like women's football is, in my view, correctly promoted, but it seems to be somehow a cultural project. It's interesting for me, at least, Julian, to think that whilst in the game, you were very much regarded at the extreme end of masculinity, particularly if you associate masculinity with combat and violence, and yet you have become a very successful figure within the female game. So can you tell me, are there any, is that, are those two worlds at odds with one another? What differences are there in the games, or are the same fundamental principles apply regardless of gender or sex?
For me, as a manager of managing the West Ham Ladies, it was the same. Like, I treated them the same as the men. At the end of the day, if they needed a bollocking, I would give them a bollocking. I had one or two cry on me, which I've never had that in the man's game. But again, like, there's obviously like the World Cups, the European Championship for the ladies, and obviously the Super Leagues. It just needs more supporting. So when you watch the games, for me, there's, unless it's a final, there's not enough people really supporting the women's football.
So you are an advocate for the women's game and support of the women's game more broadly, and you regard them essentially to be the same thing. Mate, what did you think about events in Prague? Do you think it's significant for West Ham? Me and Gareth were talking about the fact that even though anyone who knows anything about the game recognises that it's, you know, the third tier of European football, it doesn't seem that that's proportionate to the emotional impact or the cultural impact or the social impact it's had on West Ham. Why is that, mate?
Well, at the end of the day, it's a final. Don't matter if it's a third tier, it is a European final. And West Ham won it. And we celebrate that. I was at the Indigo Bar at the O2, and it was electric there. I mean, there was 2,500 fans there. And it was a magnificent night, especially when Bowen scored that late goal in the 90th minute, even though the referee played an extra 8 minutes. It was just a magical night. And it's been a long time coming for West Ham.
Thanks for sending that message to my dad, Ron Brand, who broke his ribs when we celebrated that goal. And my mate, James Ohinajan, moved too rapidly and aggressively towards me, causing me to barrel eventually into my dad and for him to break 3 ribs. He's still in Kingston Hospital, thanks to the nurses and doctors there. And thank you for that video message, Julian, that you sent. Yeah, it was like a peculiar and extraordinary night, and it brought up a lot of powerful feelings. A lot of my mates are West Ham fans, and we're all very excited to have you on the show. It's really kind of you to come on, Julian. I love this book of yours, mate. It's fantastic. I'm recommending it and endorsing it. Before we wrap up, mate, can you tell me what your favourite moments as a West Ham player were, or at least the most memorable, and maybe could that include when you had a fight with Dennis Wise?
My 11 years at West Ham were magical. Even like my injuries and stuff like that, the fans are just the best fans in the world. Upton Park was the best ground in the world to play at, in my opinion. My favourite memory was getting promotion in 92-93 with Billy Bonds as our manager. That was a great feeling. And like I said, the crowd come on the pitch. Again, it reminded me a bit of the cup final when everybody just was so happy. For weeks and weeks, they were just happy.
Yeah, like the next day after the final, like during the final itself, I felt a bit numb, and I know my dad did because of his horrific respiratory system injuries. But like the next day is when I was looking at like the press conference, I felt sort of like I felt very tearful about it. It's, it brought to the surface a lot of emotions. Gareth's a Hull fan and has a particular affiliation for and affinity with Jarrod Bowen. That famous chant now, Bowen's on fire and he's shagging Danny Dyer, it seems to have become an unofficial anthem of it. Danny Dyer is the daughter of celebrity and actor Danny Dyer, very much an East End folk hero and very brilliant actor. It's pretty amazing the way these sort of phenomena emerge out of the game, Julian, isn't it? Like, the culture is so sort of potent. Extraordinary things can emerge. People's destiny gets written in moments like that. And now Jarrod Bowen's sex life is going to be something forever connected to that victory.
Yeah, I'm sure he'd be happy with that. He's at the end, like I said, it was a magical night, and I don't think anybody could say anything to wipe the smile off his face.
They can't. In fact, here he is. Let's have a look at a clip of Jarrod Bowen singing that song, I think, with West Ham fans on the night. Let's have a look at that. Yeah, it's good. Also, I like Danny Dyer's analysis of that. Danny Dyer, the actor who shares a name with his daughter, who indeed Jarrod Bowen is now a matter of record. He's not only shagging, I think they've got children. Yeah. They've just had twins. It's not shagging. It's not a casual relationship. They're married. This is Danny Dyer, Julian, talking about that. He's sort of quite proud of it. And I think he says he sometimes starts a chant. Yeah. It's good.
What do you make of the song, by the way, as well? I've got to ask.
Well, I think there's a bit of romance in it.
Who said chivalry was
it? Think about it, all right? It's a compliment. They're saying Bowen is on fire, all right?
So which is
unreal. Yeah. And he's also shagging Danny Dyer. So if you think about it, it's like they're saying it can't get any better. So there's a compliment in there.
You know, I'm sure you're the winner in that one.
Listen, sometimes I'll start the song off over West Ham. I'm not even going to lie.
That's amazing. That's amazing, the kind of rationalisation. Even not the honour of his daughter, but certainly a song that involves shagging her, can be recontextualised positively at a time like this. Julian, thank you so much for joining us, mate. Well done writing this book. It's a fantastic read. We'll post the link in the description now for where to order it. Thanks, Julian, and thank you for the amazing service that you gave to West Ham United and the game, for being a brilliant coach for West Ham ladies, and congratulations on your book, mate.
Thank you very much.
Julian, thank you very much. Julian's book, Hammer Time, is out now. The other thing about that song, Bowen's on fire and he's shagging, the first time we ever discussed it, mate, was when it was sung about Will Gregg because of
That's
the Sunderland
right.
Till I Die
Will Gregg, yeah.
documentary. They
yeah.
go, Will, is it Grigg or Gregg?
Grigg, I think.
Will Grigg, let us know in the chat. Will Grigg's on fire. But then I don't know how they finished it, actually, because he weren't shagging Danny Dyer.
No,
I mean,
he wasn't. This,
we're not taking it in that direction.
No. Now, this is better.
Yeah, because the tagline is better than the on fire
bit.
The other thing I want to say, though, is I think the original lyrics of that song are Free From Desire.
Correct.
That's a weird thing to have a song about, because that's a very... Like, I mean, that's actually one of the most spiritual concepts that there is.
Right.
Free From Desire.
God, yeah.
Like, you're free from it. Like, the one way
it's
to...
It's about enlightenment.
It's a song that's about, literally about enlightenment, because they say one way to make yourself happy is by getting what you want, but that is so unlikely, erratic and rare, like West Ham winning a trophy. The other way is to let go of desire, to become free from desire. Mm. And you're shagging Danny Dyer. It's like a really weird sort of, when you sort of tie it together. Like, I'm surprised this song called Free From Desire could be a success. Mm. It's such a difficult message.
Yeah.
It's a hard message to carry. Who could have predicted it? Probably Gareth Roy, who seems to have an uncanny ability to predict outcomes of footballing events. This is our final predictions week now, and we will reveal the champion. I love this. Did Jack make that? Because that's his best graphic achievement, in my opinion, because yellow indicates correct score, green is 100% correct. Gareth correctly predicted the result. In fact, when Fiorentina equalised on the night, you went, my prediction was 2-1.
Yeah.
You said
I stood by it.
He spelt correct wrong. Oh, let's have a look. Jack, look at the top of the screen. You've misspelled, even in his best graphic, he's misspelled a word that he uses twice. Just look at that in the top corner, right? Green equals correct. Yellow equals correct result. Oh. Red, wrong. Oh, he's just connected it now. Where's my fucking Lionel Richie thing? If you can work so quickly on the job, I want my stay you, stay free, stay for always. So Gareth wins that. So Gareth's doing his own treble. You're not amalgamating that into the other league. So there you go. Gareth has won the European Championship. He's the champion of that. He's done a double. If there's another competition, he'll probably win that. It's hegemony. Are you backed by the Saudis?
Yes.
Are you backed by Abu Dhabi?
That's right.
I'm trying to make ends meet on my Rumble money. I'm a plucky underdog. West Ham's like money comes out of porn.
Yeah, I know, yeah, yeah.
The sweet smell of wanking is what's behind West Ham United's success. Well, listen, that's all we've got time for this week on Football Is Nice. We will be back next week. Until then, thank you for joining us on Football Is Nice. Football.